have a prosthesis, which is a ways down the road. So, oh, you raised
her. It was nice to see her picture.
Oh, yes.
So we can relate to her.
Yeah, it was good. Yeah, got a picture of the prayer chain of Paula and her Joe. So that's pretty cool. Any other prayer requests? Yes, ma'am.
Can you give me prayers for Tim Hagen?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Did you want me to share? Just continue.
Yeah, we just got news that Tim has a problem.
I had a joy since you weren't sharing.
Yes.
Lila's play is on Thursday.
Oh yeah, it is.
That's
it
a is. Joy. She's been working very hard on that.
I just don't want to like promote my kids' stuff.
I know, that's why I said it.
Yeah. Don't watch my kids. I'll know if you're not there. No, but there's more info about it on the bulletin board right there. It's on a blue sheet of paper. It's not a choice for a flyer, but dark blue sheet of paper. But yeah, it's this Thursday night. It's a bunch of pieces from musicals. And she has several parts in it. And yeah, she's been practicing for, I don't know, a long time.
When is that? On Thursday?
Thursday night. I think it's at 7. But there's a flyer there on that bulletin board that has all the info. But yeah, I wasn't going to say anything about it.
But I will.
Yeah, you can. Somebody else can. And if you want, you know, feel free to promote your kids and grandkids and great-grandkids, you know, performances, games, or whatever, during Joyce. Yes, ma'am.
My grandson plays third regionals of the state wrestling tournament this week.
Cool. What's his name?
Tyler Bailey.
Any other joys in or concerns? Yes.
Some kind of joy.
partners that we have all over the world. Because there are so many people in need and suffering somewhere on this planet at all times, especially right now in Ukraine and Turkey and Syria. There are so many suffering, so many grieving. And we ask that you bless them. We ask that you bring the war in Ukraine to an absolute end, Lord, very, very quickly. We pray that you, your Spirit would guide us in the ways of peace. That peace would begin with each and every one of us. Also, Lord, we ask for your Spirit to guide us to the feet of our Savior, Jesus Christ, where we find guidance and hope and healing and life and forgiveness and comfort and encouragement. Keep us close to our Savior at all times, Lord. Help us to follow him every step of the way, every single day, Lord. And today, Lord, we ask for your blessing on Joe. We ask for good news from his procedure today. And we also ask your blessing on his family, especially his daughter Paula, as she recovers from that terrible accident. And we ask your blessing on Tim. We ask for healing for him and a sense of your presence and your peace for him and his family. We also give thanks to Mary Carol. Recovery for her. Lord, we ask your blessing upon Elsie and a successful procedures tomorrow, and we ask for peace for her and her family. And we continue to ask for healing for me. We give you thanks that the cancer treatments are going well. We give you thanks for that and ask for healing for that. And again, the infections. Also continue to ask for you, for Charlene's dad. And we ask your blessing upon Lindsay's grandma. She makes the transition into assisted living. We ask that you give her a sense of your presence and your peace. Lord, we ask your blessing upon Terry's family as they care for his father-in-law. And we ask, Lord, that you would send forth mowers to us. Also, Lord, we give you thanks for Lila's upcoming show on Thursday. We ask your blessing upon you. Thanks for Tyler's tremendous wrestling accomplishment. We ask your blessing upon him. We ask all of this in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the Gospel to Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 39. The word of the Lord. What did the Pharisees ask Jesus to eat with them? And when he went into the Pharisees' house, he reclined to dine. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisees' house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears, and dry them with her hair, kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known and who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner. Word of the Lord. Yeah. Well, she may have been a sinner, but she knew right where to be. the best place to be, at Jesus' feet. We get what we need at Jesus' feet. Now that might sound like a jingle for a Christian shoe store, but it's true. It's true. Love, life, forgiveness, healing, guidance, whatever we need, that's the place to go, to Jesus' feet. It's a very popular place in the Gospel according to Luke. In chapter 8, Jesus drives out a legion of demons from a man, and after that, the people of his village find him at Jesus' feet. And then later, chapter 8, a mighty man falls down at Jesus' feet and begs him to come to his house and heal his daughter. And then on the way there, a woman falls down before him, before Jesus, after he healed her. Now it doesn't explicitly say at Jesus' feet in that particular story, but she fell down before him, and that's where his feet are. So, it's science. In chapter 17, a former leper prostrates himself at Jesus' feet after Jesus healed him. And then in chapter 10, there's the most famous, probably most popular at Jesus' feet story about Mary and Martha. Mary sat at Jesus' feet to hear his words while her sister Martha stayed busy working. And then Martha asked Jesus to tell Mary to help her work. But Jesus told Martha that Mary had chosen the better place to be. That is always the better place to be, at Jesus' feet. So how do we get to Jesus' feet? Well, in the spiritual sense. He's not walking around here. Just spiritual. It takes love for Jesus, faith in him, humility, and sometimes even courage. And we heard all of that embodied in the woman in our scripture reading. It's obvious from what we heard. She loves Jesus very much. And by what she did for him. And I tell you, I'd be right there with her. But I'd be afraid that scrubbing my Lord's feet with my fuzzy head would just tickle the heck out of me. I don't know if he's ticklish, though. It doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible. I have no way of knowing. I think it would be a good team, though. I could really get in there and scrub, and then you need the hair to kind of wipe away the rest. That would work really well. Anyways, and she had faith that he was more than a prophet, that he could set her free from the tremendous burden of her sins upon her, which only God can do. Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus does that. Jesus tells her at the end of this story, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. And it was an extremely humble act of love and faith, washing and kissing his feet and anointing them with oil, ointment. It was courageous. Yes, she walked in uninvited to a room full of men and went somewhere that was totally off limits to her. She went to Jesus' feet. And really, in any culture, if we didn't know who Jesus was, her actions would seem pretty strange. But back in first century Hebrew culture, a woman certainly didn't touch and kiss the feet of a man to whom she was not married. Nor did she let her hair down before any man except her husband. And if she was ritually unclean or a sinner, as she's labeled in the text, she could cause anyone she touched to become unclean as well. And this is like the ancient version of cooties. Yes, she bravely crossed all those cultural barriers to get to Jesus' feet. And there's something else, something that's very powerful, a powerful lesson to be learned in that loving, faithful, humble, and courageous posture at Jesus' feet, which Reverend Richard Wormbrand learned many, many years ago. Richard was a converted Romanian Jew who became a Christian minister who was imprisoned for preaching against Romania's vicious communist regime come just a few years after World War II. The Socialist Republic of Romania had a strict doctrine of state atheism. And when the government attempted to control the churches, Richard immediately began an underground ministry to his people. And here's how he described his imprisonment. He said for 14 years he saw no children, no women, no color. There was just the gray of his prison clothes and the gray of the uniforms of the guards and his torturers. He was kept deep underground. He spent many years in solitary confinement. And he was tortured both physically and psychologically. And yet, in the darkness and solitude of his cell, he had experiences of the presence of God more glorious than any he'd ever seen and heard. So, one night he prayed to Jesus. He said, "Lord, I'm all alone. I have no brothers or sisters here. I do not have your written word, animals." And he thought, as courageous as those Christians. So he shouldn't say that he's a Christian. And then he wondered, should I say I'm a pastor? Well, he did not dare because he knew a pastor was to watch his flock day and night, and he hadn't been like that. He hadn't done that. And so Jesus asked him, what is your name? So he bowed before Jesus and said, "Jesus, I have no name. Allow me to bear your name." And that is what Reverend Richard Wormbrand, the founder of the Voice of the Martyrs, believes Jesus really wishes to hear from all of us. He explained that the Apostle Paul understood this. He said, "Not I live, not the old Paul, not the new Paul, not the wicked Paul who had been a murderer, nor the new Paul who was an apostle, not the wicked and full of vices, not the very good and full of virtues. The I has been abolished. Not I live, but Christ lives in me." And he added, "Many Christians think we are something good, that we are talented and gifted. But Paul said, I am nothing." You see, at Jesus' feet, we learn that we are nothing without him. And that we get all we need, all our love, life, forgiveness, healing, guidance, and much more. We get that from him. Reverend Wormbrand's wife, Sabina, understood this, and she was also in prison. When she and Richard were incarcerated, their little boy, William, was taken to live with relatives, and they didn't see him for many years. However, one day, a wave of excitement passed through Sabina's barracks because the prisoners there were told they would be permitted visits from their families. Now, they wouldn't be able to sit down with family members and visit with them, but they could see them passing by and could wave at them from a distance. Not much of a visit, really. When the day came, Sabina could barely restrain herself. She was so excited. Her little son would be brought to the camp and would be visible to her from across the courtyard. Her heart leapt as she finally could see him. So this woman, who was in prison because of her faith in Jesus Christ, yelled as loud as she could, at this moment, this one chance to say anything in the world to her son, she says, "Willie, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ! Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ!" And that was it. That was her visit. All the things she could have said at that moment, all the things that seemed so natural, like, "I love you, Willie! Mommy misses you! I'll be with you soon!" She chose to tell her son to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ because she knew that's what's most important. That her son's relationship with Jesus is more important than his relationship with her. And that was also the most loving, faithful, humble, and courageous thing she could do. So do you think you can find Jesus' feet now? Most likely you've been there several times to give thanks, to learn, or to humbly ask for forgiveness beg for a healing, for words of comfort and encouragement when you needed it most. And don't worry, he doesn't turn anyone away. He's here for everyone. Jews, Gentiles, sinners, men, women, tax collectors, even at this time of year. Everyone is welcome. And you'll find it takes courage to follow in the footsteps of a Savior who's so welcoming, who's so loving, who's so forgiving. A Savior whose love and forgiveness is infinite in a world where love and forgiveness is clearly limited. At Jesus' feet. does just kept coming back to that. And all the mainline folks in the group were like, there's no accompaniment. She's just up there singing. It doesn't always rhyme. What? And then the folks that were there with her were like, oh yeah, go on, girl. Yeah, all right. All right, yeah, right on. I'll never, ever, ever forget that, though. Out of all the musical acts that night, I will never forget what she did. When I was preaching earlier, I felt like I was falling at Jesus' feet. Jesus! But, oh yeah, everybody's welcome. Everybody's welcome. Not everybody comes the same way to Jesus' feet. There's all sorts of different ways, and it might seem strange to some people and not to others or whatever. But we have our own way of getting there. Same thing with the table. Many different things lead us to this table. You might wind up in a church and not even know what you were getting into, and then you get this invitation to dine with Jesus Christ, and you say, what the heck? Yeah. No matter how you get here, it's good that you're here, and everybody's welcome. For it was on the night when our Lord was betrayed that he took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Please pray with me. Holy, gracious, and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this opportunity to commune with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is our Lord, our Master, our Guide, our Teacher, who is the embodiment of God. We give you thanks that we know him, Lord. We give you thanks that we are so freely invited into his holy presence. And we ask your blessing upon this bread and the cup, that this would truly be a time of holy time of your presence among us. We also ask your blessing upon everyone here who partakes of it. And we ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Come to the table. Thank you. guide us in Jesus' name.
Amen.